honestly, don't have prayer sessions without prophesying after. Because then you've generated power and you've burnt the power speaking English with people. You understand what I'm saying? Allow the power to leak. Brother Copeland asked him, he said, when I am believing God for the strongest of things, he said, I decrease the measure of conversation I have with people so that that power doesn't leak. Because you are using that power. So what you want to do is that you want to pray there and generate the power there, pray the revelation there, and then release that power right there into your life. And speak those words right into your life. Now, let me close with this. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 11 and verse 10. I'll close this here. 11 and verse 10. It says, for the land whither thou go to possess is not as the land of Egypt from whence you came out, where you sowed your seed and watered it with your foot. And it says, as a garden of herbs. Now, what's a garden of herbs? Jesus said, the kingdom of God is as if a man will cast seed into the ground. It is smaller than all the seeds, but when it is sown, it becometh greater than the herbs. So the herbs is the world excellence. That's a garden of herbs. The excellence there that you have in the world. But it says, when you go the kingdom way, it becomes greater. Why? But the land in which you go to possess, a land of hills that drinks of the water of the rain of heaven, which we just discussed. A land which the Lord thy God careth for. And you should be declaring this over your life, that the Lord cares for me. And that the eyes of the Lord, you don't wait to see whether it will happen. The eyes are of the Lord are always upon me from the beginning of the year, every day to the end. Should we say it? Not waiting to see whether 2016 will do that. Then we'll wait for 2017 if it doesn't happen. Are you following me? Should be declaring to your life. But it says it's a land that drinketh of the rain of heaven. Now, please understand what Jesus, and some people find this a bit disturbing if you're religious. Jesus said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, he said, you shall say to this mountain, and nothing shall be impossible to you. He didn't say God will move the mountain. He said, you shall do what? Say to this mountain. When they came and they told him about the fig tree, he said, whosoever shall say. Which means if you want any massive thing to happen, you must be saying it. He didn't say you should be asking God to do it for you. So, in the world, it says, the people that produce the garden of herbs, two things they do in the world that they excel. They sow seed, they are into charitable donations, they help people. Because you don't reap what you know, you reap what you sow. Alright, so you can know a lot, but if you sow the wrong things, is that you reap. You can know a lot. But if you are sowing wrong seeds around the whole place, that is what you reap. Okay? Even in ministry, you don't reap what you know. You reap what you sow. Alright? So, it says this, that they sow their seed, and the issue is, they water it with their foot. The difference is where our own water is coming from. Our water is coming from heaven. And it says, when that water, we saw this at the beginning, touches the work of your hands, it gets so blessed that you lend unto nations and you don't borrow. When those utterances come on what you are doing, which means everybody must be prophesying on what they are doing with their hands, it says it gets so blessed. That's why when they labored all night and caught nothing, when Jesus now spoke that word into it, they said, according to your word, we will go back into that place where we caught nothing. Do the same thing, and this time they got an abundance. That's rain fell on what they were doing. Are you following what I'm saying here? So you should be making declarations over the work of your hands, over your career. Speaking out there that I'm fruitful in every good work. And speaking that fruitfulness in what you're doing. So the two things they do is that they give, alright, and the second thing that they do is that they make declarations as people in the world. They make what is called affirmation. This is their principle. The truth is that they don't actually pray. What they do, right, is that they sow seeds, and the second thing they do is that they make pronouncements. It is the weak ones among them that go to God in prayer, can you help us with our business? Do you hear what I'm telling you? And it is the unknowledgeable people in Christianity that go to God. God, please. God, please now. God, please. Those that know God, they ask God for the utterance that they will speak. They don't ask God to do it. They ask God. They say, it's not by my power or by my might, but by your spirit. What does that mean? The flesh profited nothing. It is the spirit that quickens. The words that I speak. Jesus said, this is the commandment I've received. What I should say and what I should speak. And I know the commandment is life eternal. Which means when I go to God in prayer, he gives me the words to speak. Do you get what I said? So the person comes out. And in the world they're declaring, I'm making affirmations. I've been saying this. Yesterday, my wife comes, she was watching some of the opera. She said, hear what she just said. And she rewound it. She was speaking, I think, somewhere. And he said, listen, you know, people like us, she just said it. We believe that what we say happens. We understand the power of our words. I've said this, I saw her having a discussion with Tom Cruise. She said, few people know, he said, most people don't really know this, but those of us that believe that what we say comes to pass. So they believe in the power of their words. And they help. They do charities. Look at them. They will see them. We're helping this school. We're building it. They're doing all that. And the power of their words. He says, in the kingdom, you also are sowing seeds. He says, but your own words are not natural words. He says, what no man's eye has seen, no man's ear heard, the heart of no man conceived, the spirit has revealed. For we have received the spirit that is of God, that we might know those things that are freely given to us of God, which things we speak. Not with words that human wisdom teaches, but with words that the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual with spiritual. So it is pronouncements that they make. Someone said, I went to see somebody, a prophet. The guy is all these occulty people, rubbish. And the man starts making incantation. Oh, he just, what he's trying to do is to speak words to influence. I don't say, when he says, bring Saturday Christ, that's what he's trying to do now, to speak words to influence things. You have the most powerful words ever. Alright? Your own is not, you will speak words, Bible says, the Holy Ghost gives, that no man's eye, you will say things. That's why the Bible says kings will be startled, that what we are seeing, nobody told us. But if we're on the level of we're just praying, God, we're praying, alright, do something, then we'll be there. Quickly. Go to Psalm 89. Psalm 89. Psalm 89, it says in verse 26, he shall cry unto me, thou art my father and my God, the rock of my salvation. I will make him my firstborn higher than the kings of the earth. So it's called the kings of the earth. But it says, I will make my firstborn higher than the what? Kings of the earth. That there are kings on this earth. But my firstborn will be what? Higher. Abraham, this one that church people will be respecting people in the world. Ah, that man. Ah, hey, very wealthy. Hey, ah. Oh, that man. He says, my firstborn will be what? Higher than the what? Kings of the earth. Watch it. It's from the church. The greatest man will soon emerge. Higher than what? The king. Abraham was higher than any king around him. When they went to battle, he went to battle against formidable armies. With people in his own household, they defeated them. When it was time to bury his wife, a king came and said, we'll give you land free. He said, we don't take things free. We pay for what we want. Abraham, he said, how much will you ask if you are in business? And he told him, he brought it out and gave him cash. Isaac, the kings came and said, you are what? Mightier than us. Higher than the what? Kings of the earth. But what is stopping the firstborn manifestation? Because this firstborn is not just anybody. Because Esau sold the right to be a firstborn. There is what is called the firstborn right. Which means to be a firstborn in the kingdom of God. It's not everybody. That's why I will tell you. To Abraham and to his seed were the promises made. Not seeds as of many. There's a way you can do the scripture that you collapse the thing and eliminate people. Are you understand what I'm saying? So who is the firstborn here? Let's look at it. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Let's see something here. And this is where the unforgiveness comes. Hebrews 11:28. Through faith, he kept the Passover. The Bible says, the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. So what Satan wants to do is to destroy the firstborn and leave the body as Christian. Because the firstborns will be higher than his kings. And when you start having people higher than his own kings to preach the gospel is no longer hard. They will come and say, Rabbi, Rabbi, we don't have to knock. Gentiles will come to your light. They are kings to the brightness of your, not that you are going to meet them, they will come. So he doesn't want that. And how does he get to the firstborn? He says, that's how we started. Grudge not. Bible says they kept the Passover. Keep it without malice. Don't have any grudge inside your heart against anybody. Satan says, listen, we want to get this person out of firstborn inheritance. That's what they were trying to do to Joseph, to get him angry. That's what they were trying to do, that we will use all these things to try to get their insult, all kinds of things, to try to get them into unforgiveness. Try to get them that they hold a grudge for 13 years. Hold a grudge. They have that, what we've called it there, a grudge on the inside. It's, I've told you, the grievance industry. Playing the victim card. I've told you, nobody gets to the top. I told them school of ministry. Some of the things I went through in ministry, in going up. Nobody go and tell me I suffered something. I'm telling you that we suffered. Leave all of this. Don't make noise. What people are doing is the grievance industry, which means that I didn't get my way. Everybody that gets to the top, if you know what they've gone through, listen, you will know that, listen, they went up, but they didn't tap into that grievance. They took their time and said, look, I can't give up the right to be a firstborn. I cannot give up prophetic power because of an insult from somebody I met after I was even an adult. Are you following what I'm saying? I put this on Twitter. Before anybody threatens you or manipulates you, check your life. What did they give to you that they are holding, they feel they can hold your life? Did you send me to school? Did you give me my education? And you meet somebody one way, but starts making noise and want to take over your life. For what? Threatening you that you will not move forward because what? And people start getting grievance and all of that. Get rid of it. That's why Jesus said, when you pray, forgive. Alright? That's what happens. Because once Satan can get you offended, he gets into the life. That's why Jesus came and said, the prince of this world cometh unto me has nothing in me. That even though they have planned to kill me and Judas is one of them, when he saw Judas, he said, friend. Friend. There's no beef here. Friend. I know what you're doing, but you're my friend. Because once you do that, and I believe, in fact, today I saw when I was preaching for service, I've seen it. That what happened to Job was that Job had ought in his heart against his friends. That's how Satan got him. You say it is fear, but the Bible says perfect love casteth out fear. So what was going on was offering all the sacrifice on the outside, but with those his friends, he had something. That's why God said, go and pray for your friends. When he prayed for his friends, his captivity was turned around. Let me tell you, who will be the firstborn among people? A lot of people relate. I've only seen this in ministry. I've seen people hug people, preach for people that behind the back, they stab them. Who will be the greatest? It is the one whose heart is pure to the other person. Who, when he shakes a person's heart, there's no agenda in his heart. He prays for that person. Who is the one that will be the biggest business in any field? Is the one that even though they are competitors all around, he wishes all of them well. Who is the one whose career will go up in an office? Is the one who is praying for everybody else inside that office that they will move up. And does not take offense at what anybody in that office does to them, even when they provoke them. That's what it means, that the greatest shall be the servant of all. That's the witness of the Holy Spirit. So, this week, for 40 days to start on Monday, making these declarations there, clean your heart in prayer. Open your heart, pray for people. If it's strong, look for their photographs on Facebook. Stand there and say, in the name of Jesus, I love you. I prophesy goodness into your life. My heart is right towards you. You understand what I'm saying? Everything you set your hand upon will be blessed. All right? You do not owe me anything. I owe you the love of God. And I declare that as God gives me the opportunity to do good to you, I will. Letting go of offense doesn't mean fooling anybody. You say, excuse me, I won't tell you, you hurt me, but it means letting go and praying that God, as you see opportunity for me to do good, I do good. But I won't go and try to create an opportunity. My heart is right to this person. If the opportunity is created in 10 years' time, it is God that created the opportunity for Joseph to do good to his brothers. He didn't go and look for them. The fact that he didn't go and look for them when he was prime minister didn't mean that he hadn't forgiven them. Do you understand what I'm saying here? He didn't go and start looking for them. When he was prime minister, he was going to look for them. Then, hey, come, don't worry about what happened. Most of the time when people do that, they are trying to say something else. All right? If it's needed, God will open the door by himself. If it's not needed, that's it. But let your heart be right towards people. Are you following me? All right. So we'll start that Monday. We'll do, it'll be 6 a.m., 12 noon, and 6 p.m. And if you can't do the 6 p.m. because of, and you do 9 p.m. All right? Let's just rise to our feet and just make the clear declarations over our lives here. These are just some of the message scriptures. I'll just read them and make pronouncements. In Genesis here, the first one I'm going to use has to do with Lot. And what happened in the life of Lot in Genesis chapter 19. Here's what he said. He says, and when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city. And while he lingered, which means Lot did not respond, the angels laid hold upon his hand, upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him, and they brought them forth and set them without the city. And therefore I declare over every single person under the sound of my voice, that by the mercy of God that shall rest upon your life in the next 40 days, an angel shall be sent permanently into your family. Amen. And every single member of your family that will hold your hand, hold the hand of your spouse, hold the hand of every child that you have on the earth, wherever they may be. And even when they linger because they don't know that something bad is going to happen in that place, that angel shall pull them out of that situation. Yeah. Such that it is only with their eyes will they see the reward of the wicked upon them. Yeah. No evil shall come near their dwelling place. Yeah. In the name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. The second one I'm going to pronounce is found in Genesis here, all right, 24. And this has to do with Jacob. And here is what Jacob said. And Jacob said here, right, he said here, that Genesis 32:10. Here's what happened. Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham, the God of my father Isaac, the Lord that said unto me, return unto thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies that you have shown unto thy servant. For with my staff I passed over the Jordan, and I am become two bands. And he said, deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother who wanted to smite him because of it. Therefore I declare over your life that the mercy of God that shall rest from the result of these 40 days, as Jacob said, I went in just with the clothes on my back and one staff, but I've returned multiplied with two bands. The grace for multiplication shall rest upon you all the days of your life. That even though you're going out just with one staff, that grace shall bring a multiplication, and also that grace shall deliver you from the hand of any person that will be envious of the blessing that God has placed upon your life. Yeah. In the name of Jesus. Yeah. Such that no weapons formed or fashioned against you shall prosper. Yeah. The third one I'm going to bring out here in Nehemiah. In Nehemiah here, he said this. Yea, Yet thou in thy manifold mercies forsook them not in the wilderness. The pillar of cloud departed not from them by day to lead them in the way, neither the pillar of fire by night to show them light and the way wherein they should go. And you gave them also thy good spirit to instruct them, and you did not withhold manna and gave them water for their thirst. And 40 years you sustained them, and they lacked nothing. I declare that through the 40-day prayer, that the mercy of God shall rest upon your life. And this shall be a permanent future, that you will be guided and led by the Spirit. As there was the pillar of fire by night, during the night seasons, you will have instructions that will come by the Spirit of God, showing you that this is the way to go. And during the daytime of prosperity and increase, the Holy Spirit also will be that pillar of cloud to shield you from trials and tribulation, and to also show you the way to go in the time of increase. You shall lack nothing on the earth in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you for watching.